Hello everyone, my name is Anthony Cianciolo, and this is Daniel Dottogni, and I'm very, very grateful to be here. Thank you to Sky, and thank you to the San Francisco Conservatory Music and the TAC program. Daniel and I are gonna kind of walk you through our process. So I am making a film about a crazy punk rock drag queen named Jerome Chaya, who is a local San Francisco celebrity, very, very loved here. He died in San Francisco in 1995 from complications related to HIV and AIDS. And I knew Jerome, I loved Jerome. He was an inspiration at a time when my community was just really hit and hard. And he was that kind of beacon of light at a time when we had very, very little to celebrate about. So I'm gonna walk you through a little bit about my film, and I'm gonna share with you our process and what I gave Daniel to work with. And basically, Daniel and I did something very, very different from what most people would do. So in the TAC program, most of the filmmakers gave like a little excerpt, like 2 to 5 minutes of their film to the composers, and then the composers would, you know, create a little score. And I told Daniel, I said, we're gonna do something very, very different. I said, I would love for you to be a part on a development level. And I said, I would love to actually edit to something that he would write. And I basically gave him a homework assignment. I said, I want you to be inspired by Jerome. I said, I'm gonna give you some art. I'm gonna show you what we gave him. And I said, I want you to bring something to the table that I couldn't conceive of. And Daniel was, you know, up to the challenge, and do you want to?
Sure.
Anything like that?
Sure. So, in one of our first few meetings, Anthony asked me to create some sort of like small musical idea that could reflect a lot of the artwork that I've been perusing by Jerome. And one of my initial reactions was to do something a little unorthodox with how to use the piano. And I just popped open the lid and did this thing where I call it piano pizzicato, where you just kind of deaden the piano string at the very end of it, and then you kind of thunk it really hard, and it creates this kind of piano pizzicato sound. And that eventually became Jerome's motif, which is this very kind of enigmatic, dark sound with lots of rich overtones. Just to reiterate, what we're doing is a little unorthodox. Most of the time in film scoring, you start with the film first, and then you score to it. However, in this process, we're doing some things a little backwards. And we are starting with the music in certain sections of this film, and then using that as kind of a roadmap for various sections of the film.
Okay, so we're gonna walk you through a little slideshow, and this is the stuff that I handed Daniel. And I was, I wanted to give him something a little bit more kind of minimal to work with, because there's so much art that this queen had made. So I gave him what you're going to see. So we're going to kind of flip through this. So go to the next slide, Carl. So this is our first spotting session. And this is some imagery of Jerome. This is his best friend, Anna, took some photographs of Jerome in drag. So next slide. And Jerome was kind of the poster child for a lot of these crazy queer zines that were happening in the late 80s, early 90s. So like Homo Core, Jerome was on the cover of that. So this is Jerome in his studio here with the nail polish. And you can see he barely had room to even sleep in his studio because he was painting with all the material that he would find in the purse of a drag queen. So lipstick, eyeliner, makeup, this was the material that he would paint with. And most people know the crazy kind of punk rock drag side of Jerome, but what they don't know is that he was a master American painter. So, next slide. So this is some of Jerome's art. These are on tiny little scraps of paper. So this stuff is, you know, 7 inches by 4 inches. This is all done with nail polish. And a lot of this material is in the Smithsonian Archives of American Art. So he's, you know, what's extraordinary about his story is he was actually alive and he was able to write himself down into the art history books, basically. The Smithsonian took his papers in and he was able to give them, you know, some of his most prized possessions as far as the art that he had. So, next slide. This is, you know, Jerome had like a lot of, like, you know, religious motifs in a lot of his work. The New Eyes for St. Lucy, this is painted on a tip tray. So these are all like found objects, they're bottle caps. or the tip trays that you get when you go out to dinner at like a Chinese restaurant, you collect this stuff and you would paint on a lot of these things. Next slide. Go back one, Carl. So I'm just going to talk just a little bit about this, just so you can get a little bit of context around Jerome, because I use this piece in particular for Daniel just to get inspired. You know, one of the themes is, you know, sacred and profane is a theme in a lot of Jerome's art. And so this is a piece, what I love about this is that most people think that Jerome is an outsider artist. He's actually an insider. He resonates with outsiders, but he's an insider who's classically trained. He went to school. He's referencing Goya's painting here, which is Saturn devouring his son. This is a painting of his one of his best friends, Charlie Sexton. Both of them are HIV positive. They both went to the San Francisco Institute of Art. They made a pact with each other, and they basically said, whoever is the loser in life and dies first has to bequeath their ashes to whoever survives. So Charlie died first. Jerome got all of Charlie's ashes, and for 2 years, Jerome mixed Charlie's ashes with nail polish and made a huge body of work. And this is one of the pieces that Jerome made. It's just really exquisite. It's, you know, one of the probably top 10 most coveted pieces by Jerome. So next slide. This is also on a tip tray. Thanks for having turkey dinner. Next slide. And then Jerome also is very famous for a lot of provocative art, provocative content. One of the things that my film is going to do is to really put a lot of art like this into context. So next slide. So at the end of our first spotting session, this little piece of paper, this was notes that I had. And Daniel kept looking over my shoulder. He's like, what is that? What are you looking at? I wasn't going to give him this. And this little piece of paper, Daniel's like, I like that. I want to work with that. And so at the end of the spotting session, I pulled out this little tiny painting that Jerome did. I put this in his hand. And I said, Daniel, I want you to take this painting along with all these other paintings that I showed you. I said, I want you to create some kind of like cinematic soundscape and bring this art to life. So this is how we kind of like ended our session. And the thing that Daniel was most inspired with was this little piece of paper with my themes that were on it. And Daniel, do you want to share anything?
Sure.
Something that I think is really interesting about this project, other than this being just a very inspiring man who was once lived an extremely artistically inspiring life, is the concepts of black and white, and how there not being much gray area between. For example, if you the achromatic toolkit, it has very extreme concepts on either side. I thought that was really interesting that we're not really trying to dwell so much in the gray area between. And I think that's really prevalent in a lot of Jerome's art. He has very provocative imagery, which has lots of Christian iconography, but also a lot of humor and human gentleness and humanity in it. And I think this is a really, I thought this was really striking and interesting representation of his body of work. And I found it very inspiring in the compositional process.
So we're going to play a little video. So from all of this, I gave Daniel some video of Jerome, and I also gave him just a little animated logo for my film, and again, it's just in black and white. So we're gonna play something, and Daniel wrote the music, and this was recorded. This was recorded at Skywalker Sound, and Daniel wrote this for like a 9 or 10 piece orchestra. So we're gonna switch to this little teaser and play this. This is something that we actually threw into a combination of black and white art because I was inspired by Daniel. He really loved that little graphic. I decided to go and make a bunch of art inspired from Daniel. So we're going to show you a couple of things that I created and kind of bounce back into Daniel so that he could continue writing more music. So let's do the the present slideshow.
Okay.
So with this achromatic toolkit, so let's go next slide, Carl. So I decided to make a whole bunch of graphics like this. So we took like sacred and profane, we've got the definitions of both of those, then we have consonants and dissonance, and then I took those as the two main themes, and I came up with a whole laundry list of themes that are in that film. And so Daniel took this and kind of ran with it. There's a couple other pieces in there. Go to the next slide, Carl. So this is an optical illusion. So you'll notice that there's a bunch of little black dots that keep kind of like flashing around. What I love about this is, like, again, Jerome, to me, is like there's something scintillating that's going on. It's not something black, it's not something white, but there's something else that's happening in between the black and white, and it's not gray. This is what led Daniel and I to creating Jerome's motif. And Daniel, do you want to play Jerome's motif? Daniel's gonna play this. Before he plays it, I kind of gave him a homework assignment and said, dude, you really like all this black and white, kind of polar opposite themes and stuff. I said, here's a piano key. You know, we have our second spotting session. I said, find Jerome on this piano. I said, you got one shot at it. And basically, Daniel just popped the lid on the piano like a mechanic, like a veteran mechanic, and instead of hitting a piano key, he reached in and plucked a chord like he would pluck a harp, and he nailed it. And so this is what came out of the achromatic toolkit, and this is Jerome's motif. From Jerome's motif, I was telling Daniel, I said, there's all this crazy imagery of Jerome from the late 80s, early 90s, a bunch of industrial music, Jerome's, you know, performing a lot. I said, before we get to all that kind of fun stuff, I said, let's nail the sensitive, sweet, tender side to Jerome. And so from Jerome's motif, the next thing that we kind of migrated to was to create a piece of art that really shows a human side of Jerome. And so you can go to the next slide, Carl, go to the next slide. So do you want to say anything about the motif?
Sure. Cool. With the soundtrack, we really wanted to solidify the core of it, which is kind of the more human and gentle side of this whole project, and trying to represent that humanity in Jerome, and not really the marginalized provocateur. So I've had this kind of little waltz motif, like idea, floating around my head for a while, and it's very gentle and lovely, and I've been playing around with it the past several months, and thought this would be perfect for this. It's kind of quirky and humorous, and it has just the right amount of like bite, but it resolves, and I think it works really well.
And Carl, you can go to the next slide. And I'm just gonna share a little story before we actually play this piece that Daniel wrote. We were bouncing a bunch of stuff back and forth in Google Drive, and you know, I looked on Google Drive and I see this thing and it says Jerome's Waltz. And the first time I saw it, I was like, oh my God. I was like, no, this is going terribly wrong. Because Jerome is this fierce, you know, strong, independent, strong-willed individual who kind of marched to the beat of his own drum. He did his own thing, his own way. He didn't dance with anyone. But I buttoned my lip and I was just like, just listen. And so we're gonna play the mock-up that Daniel did that we ended up taking to Skywalker Sound. So we're gonna play Jerome's Waltz for you right now.
Yeah, sure, sure. And just a preface, this is a bunch of basically synthesizers playing it back to us. So this is just a very rough mock-up. So this is for your musical perusal. Thank you.
So when I heard this piece actually made me cry because Daniel did exactly what I had asked him to, which was to bring something to the table that I couldn't conceive of. And basically this piece completely transformed how I'm moving forward with my film. I quickly realized like my film is about this man who died from complications from HIV and AIDS in the last year of his life, who was forced to learn how to dance with others. And he had to learn how to dance with his best friend, who basically was filming him and taking care of him and helping him get his papers into the archives of American art. And so my film is really a love story, and it's a, this beautiful film about a dance between him and his best friend. And this is something that I actually was born to while I was making my film, and Daniel actually really helped me get back in touch with the core of my film by writing this piece, The Waltz. And so, again, this is moving forward. There's going to be a waltz and a dance that's going to be happening in the background of my film. So we're going to play a we're going to play this piece that Daniel actually overlaid over some video.
So the footage you're about to see is a footage shot of Jerome with a, I believe it's like a camcorder, and he's lying in bed and he's very ill and it's nearing the end of his life, and he's talking about lots of very kind of emotionally touching things like his childhood and never really fitting in and just things like that and how he. And so one thing I noticed musically is he has a very like naturally kind of for lack of a better word, sing-songy way of speaking. He has a natural rhythm to it, which I thought was really interesting. That was kind of the groundwork I laid for like having the having the groove of the music kind of fit in with the film. And so when a person is talking, that's always the most important thing. You don't want to cover that up with the music. And so my intention was to have the music kind of enhance what he was saying. And yeah, that's about it.
I was always real sensitive as a young child, and then. Much more living in a fantasy world all the time. I mean, my major dreams or whatever when I was young was that I was either adopted and any day now my real parents were going to come get me, or I was from outer space.
Really?
And the spaceship was going to come and get me. They accidentally left me behind, but they were going to come. Oh yeah. And I truly believed both of those things at different times. One of those had to be true. Of course, I look so much like my parents now, I can't believe those wonderful facts. And all my relationships with love were on objects, inanimate objects. I married
like
my
the plants
blanket.
And the...
I married my blanket, and after I told my mind, and I used to chew
this blanket?
It. No, not this blanket. It was a soft, fuzzy blanket with yellow roses on it. And I used to chew holes in it because I believed it was a real thing and the holes would grow back closed. Because I would have had a hole in it and the fibers would go, oh, it's healing. So I used to chew holes all over it just so that it would heal. And then my mom took it away from me.
Daniel brought out this really sweet, really tender side to Jerome, which I think is like key in my film. And we're gonna, do you wanna add anything? So Carl just pulled the Prezi, and we're gonna just end on, there's a couple really magical things that actually happened. We're gonna end on a really lovely note. When I came here for the first spotting session with Daniel, I was on the phone with my partner. He's like, where are you going? Where's this at? And you can flip through the next couple slides, Carl. When we were coming in to the front door, Carl's like, where's this place at? And I was like, oh, it's at 50 Oak Street. And Carl's like, 50 Oak Street? Carl's like, I think that's where Jerome used to work. So Jerome used to be the towel boy and used to work for the gym that was in this building. The gym that was in this building was in the basement, and the pool is right where we're at right now. So it's really funny because it's like bringing Jerome back home again. So with that said, can you go back one slide, Carl? So Jerome comes from a family of 11 boys, and Jerome grew up in Cleveland, and this is just another one of those cool stories. So Mary Claire, who is, who created the TAC program, is also from Cleveland. So this is when I knew, I was like, I'm home, I'm in the right place with Jerome. So next slide, Carl.
Which one?
I'm also from Cleveland too, by the way, from Lakewood. So the next slide, Carl. Or actually, does anybody know which one's Jerome in that picture?
No.
Can you guess? Is that just like his mom? Yeah, the one with the glasses. Bingo, you got it. One of the things that like kept going over the back of my mind is I remember a painting that Jerome had done of the facade of the building. It's the only painting that he had done. And once I realized that Jerome used to work in this building, I went to my friend who had that painting in their collection, and I realized that this is the Conservatory of Music, the facade of the building. And Jerome made this painting in the late 80s, early 90s. And so I printed this up and I made some postcards, and this is a gift for everyone. So come see Carl, myself, or Daniel, and we'll hand these out to you.
Yeah, I just want to